Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to Entrepreneur India's Resilience Series. During the lockdown, we all ate home-cooked food, mostly because of the fear of the virus transmission, of course. We experimented, watched online videos, followed chefs to make all those food items we crave for at home. Not all succeeded, including me. So it is not a surprise that once it was clarified that the virus cannot transmit through food, people started ordering food and eating out. Now, with the unlock phases going on, QSR joints and other food serving startups are slowly witnessing sales. But is everything back to normal, or what is the new normal? That is what we will find out today. I'm Saurav Kumar, Editor, Special Projects, Entrepreneur India, the moderator for the session. To update our Facebook viewers, the discussion will last for 45 minutes and will be followed by taking up questions from you. Post your questions through the comment section and do mention if you want a specific panelist to answer it. Let me now introduce our panelists for the day. We have with us today Ms. Nidhi Singh, co-founder Samosa Singh, Mr. Dheeraj Gupta, founder and MD of Jumbo King, Ms. Padmaja Ruparel, co-founder of Indian Angel Network, Mr. Vishal Jindal, co-founder and co-CEO of Skygate Hospitality Private Limited, which runs Biryani by Kilo, and Mr. Shah Miftur Rahman, co-founder and CFOO of Wow Momo. Welcome, everyone. So let me start with a very basic question. So have the sales regained the pre-COVID levels, or are people still awaiting a vaccine to be fully sure about, that everything is safe? So Miftur, if I can start with you.
So thank you, Saurav. Good afternoon, everyone. It's March 12, so we can say good afternoon. So if you say that have the numbers gone back, so A is numbers, B is life. Life has definitely not gone back to normal, to the pre-COVID level. And hence, I don't think the numbers would go back, especially for the food industry. As we talk, if we need to give an example of Wow Momo, we are about 75% of the pre-COVID number, with less than about 65% stores operating. So there were a set of stores which we operated prior to COVID, and those locations just don't make sense anymore. Because A, the footfall for those locations have drastically reduced. There are places where people used to earlier flock, say in terms of food courts or in malls or in busy high street locations. People would go in and flock there in totality, but now nobody is going there. Even if they are going, they're not stopping to eat. So what has been definitely taken a hit, and food and hospitality, all of us know, has been the worst hit sectors. So what has definitely taken a hit is socializing, which was the earlier norm for eating out. Now that has taken a hit. What has picked up instead is delivery. So delivery is the new normal, pre-order takeaway is the new normal, but the importance, or rather the share of the pie which the delivery has increased right now, does not commensurate to the fall in the dining experience which we earlier used to have. So net, the industry is operating between 50 to 70%. The smaller formats, the delivery focused formats, are ranging between 60 to 70. The dine-ins is a little lower. The fine dine restaurants are operating below 50, but that's how the new normal is.
Mm. Okay, Dheeraj, what's your experience?
Yeah, so hi everyone. So our stores are largely located around the railway stations, the metros in Mumbai city. And with the trains being shut down, I think business came to a complete standstill. And, of course, even colleges were shut, schools were shut. So it was difficult. I think all the way till, I think for the first 6 months, we were not doing much other than a little bit of Swiggy Zomato, which was happening. But over the last 3 months, I think with Diwali and all of these things happening where shopping resumed, business has, actually we are at about 60% of pre-COVID levels. And I think we give ourselves a 5-star for being able to do this because the trains are still not functioning. I think just having a very positive outlook towards what is going on makes a lot of difference. So, yes, with trains opening in Mumbai city, things should get back to normal. So we are not in the socializing part of it's more of a need-based thing. It's like when people are traveling and they need a quick snack on the go. So that is where Jumbo King comes as a good option for people, where it is, very well priced and you know, it does not spoil the dinner that a person is going to have after a couple of hours when he reaches home. So yes, we are taking a body blow as far as COVID is concerned. And I think all of us are in the same boat. So you have to just, I say grin it, as in smile and just take it when it is bad. But yes, we are preparing. We've done a lot of groundwork in terms of training, in terms of, you know, understanding how the systems can be made stronger so that when this opens up, we can hit the ground running.
Right. Obviously, everyone, I think that this is a good time for introspection for everyone. So maybe I'll come to you. If you can, you know, tell me how the sales are. And also, you know, I would want to know from you that once the lockdown started, I mean, obviously, we were not prepared for it, or some people may have an idea because other countries were imposing it, but we were not sure about lockdown here. How did you react? What did you do?
Right. So for us, see, Samosa Singh, first of all, good afternoon to everyone. It's really nice to be here in the panel. Just answering the question here, it was, for us, Samosa Singh is also a manufacturing company. So rather than having our cloud kitchens and online businesses through delivery, we also are a manufacturing company. So we are one of the largest manufacturers of samosas and other Indian snacks in the south part of the country. So definitely, when lockdown happened, no one assumed it would be of this gravity. And just before lockdown, just 1 month prior to it, we invested very heavily into opening a nice flagship store at the Bangalore International Airport. That was one of our heaviest investment till date. You know, in 4 years of business, that was one of the heaviest investment, and we really had high hopes. But just as the lockdown happened, the first cut of lockdown was in the multiplexes. And Samosa Singh had a significant presence in PVRs and INOX. We actually used to supply to them across Bangalore and Hyderabad. So certainly that business part was completely shut. The airport, again, was the second major hit. And in the airport, no one even comes to the airport in the quad area and other things once the airport is not functional. So we saw a major part of our business, you know, completely shut due to lockdown, which was all our B2B supplies, which would happen to all these institutional players, which would be multiplexes, and as well as the airlines. So certainly the B2B part was business was completely shut. We never assumed it would go this long, but that was one major hit that we faced as a company. On the other hand, we were always primarily trying to expand our presence in the cloud kitchen domain. And we already had about 15 kitchens just around the time of COVID. The cloud kitchen part of the business was where we saw the demand really increasing. In fact, that particular part of the business never saw any major hunch. The challenge that we had to overcome, though, during the lockdown was to make sure that the cloud kitchens were operational. Initial days, April, May, we actually had to get so many permissions, so many special licenses to be able to operate those kitchens. But certainly, the demand was there. It was a challenge to make sure we fulfill the demands by keeping those kitchens open. So during lockdown, 50% of our business was completely shut. But within these 6 months of lockdown, we have actually made 90% of our business through these cloud kitchens. And that 10%, which was a B2B, now we are even contemplating that as a business, do we really need to go there? Because like you said, it's something that lockdown or COVID is the new normal, and it's going to take significant time for market to roll back. So I think there has been very huge learnings. As a production, we had to make our team really lean. We had to leverage all the capex that we had and kind of try to make something more out of it, get more results in the production so that the company could run on a more self-sustaining mode. I'll share what we did, you know, maybe throughout further discussions. But those were the things that let us keep going. And the cloud kitchen business, which Dheeraj also just referred to, and even Shah mentioned that it is something which has really picked up, the online deliveries. And just during the lockdown, we have actually expanded in now 35 kitchens. So where we were in 10, we are now in 35. So we have actually grown that part of the business well during COVID.
Okay, fair enough. So before I go to Padmaja, I'll ask Vishal to give us his view. You know, you sell something which is the favorite food of India, which is biryani. So tell us how has your, what you did and has your sales gone back to where it was earlier?
Oh, Saurav, I'll say biryani by kilo. I think we were positioned well enough. as a delivery company and as an online company and a biryani category. So I think, of course, we had, and I'll talk about the challenges during COVID, but we are back to, if I can say, humbly 110% of our pre-COVID levels. So because our dine-in used to be 10% and 90% was delivery. So that dine-in, which was 10%, is now 5%, but the delivery, which was 90%, is now 105%. So overall, we are back to 110%, and we signed 4 new outlets last month and 2 outlets. So in a way, I think we always have been a cloud kitchen. We always have been in biryani category 5 years. We always also, I think, biryani by kilo, because our positioning and the truth is that we make fresh biryani at every order, and the handi is sealed. So in the same handi in which we do the cooking, we deliver. So the customer knows this. So they know it is very safe. The sealed handi is opened by the customer, and biryani as a category. And of course, we were always positioned as a company in terms of delivery as cloud kitchens. We have 40 cloud kitchens across India in more than 20 cities now, and delivery. So I think all that is in the tech and the whole organizational DNA. So sometimes, you know, the dine-in companies, of course, they can do delivery, but I think the DNA of a company to be a delivery company takes a lot more in the tech and everything. So touch wood, I think because of being a fresh biryani, which is safe, and delivery technology and positioning like that. And so we are quite back and quite happy about it. But it was a very difficult period, April, May, June. Like Nidhi was saying, you know, we all had to get special licenses just to get teams going, keep their morale up. All the management has to work double the hours. And, you know, normal hours are also 9-10 hours. So double the hours is just you're working. And I think we also did a lot of communication with the customers. We are the first ones, if I can say, to come out with safety videos in, you know, as soon as the lockdown happened, and implement all those safety measures, like putting all employees, which everyone is putting now. I think we started doing very, very early, and all, you know, sanitization of kitchens, bags, all those safety communication, etc. I think had, but touch wood, we are back around 110%, and we're signing a lot of new outlets. So I think we're in good position. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, fair enough. Good to hear from you that you passed the, you know, you reached the, regained the peak. So Padmaja, I'll come to you. You heard 4 entrepreneurs in operating in different segments. You know, some sales back to 60%, some to 110%. Someone saying that, you know, we have gone to some other business and we find that, do we need to go back to B2B? So here you are an investor, you've already invested in food business. So what do you make of this thing? Like people who were in cloud kitchen models, say earlier, and were not into QSR mode, maybe, is this a blessing in disguise, or how do you think, how do you see the space?
You know, thank you, Saurabh, first of all, and congratulations to Entrepreneur India to host this panel and get these kind of founders we have who really built, I think, awesome companies and lip packing products. But I think, you know, from an investor perspective, in some ways, the pandemic has been a blessing. Okay, let me tell you why. When we invest, and IEL primarily is an investor in seed and early stage companies, right? And at a seed and early stage, it is our main bet, 70% of our diligence or bet is on the entrepreneurs, right? And the pandemic has actually done our job for us because it has stress tested for us, the entrepreneurs. How have they gone through come out standing through the COVID tunnel, and how did they do it, right? So I think that is one, that's how we view the pandemic, and how has each entrepreneur withstood it. So for instance, you know, Vamomo did do essentials, somebody else went into cloud kitchens, somebody else who was completely, for instance, you know, there are tons of dine-in restaurants which were completely closed and they went into delivering food. There are 5-star hotels which have created delivery packs of very high quality premium catered food without actually catering it, right? So they've created these menu, they've created these recipes, packed it in proportions, given instructions how to cook it, and people are doing it at home. So I think these are the genetics which have come to fore to say how you handle a tough situation. This is a situation, as Dheeraj said, it's really something which has come into the gut and you can't do anything but just handle it, right? So how you handle it is something which is very important. Number two, I think, is yes, when we look at it from an industry perspective, 75% to 80% food businesses have come back to pre-COVID stage from a GMV perspective. The point which I think we worry about is what happens on the bottom line perspective, because that is a very different ballgame. So I think the focus therefore starts happening on costs, on procurement and supply chains. Packaging costs may have gone up. So I think the EBITDA piece is where we start thinking about. The third piece, I think, from a customer-driven perspective, and I think a lot of it has been already shared by Vishal, Dheeraj Shah, Miftor, and Nidhi. But I think the one shift that if I look at it from a macro view is especially for ordering foods, you know, delivered foods, I think there is a shift in customer. Especially when you look at the young corporate crowd, which is actually ordering the max, it's the target audience which orders maximum online delivery. I think they've gone home. They're working from Jalandhar and Jaipur and other places. I think there is a clear shift, and that shift is something that the businesses which are only focused on perhaps metropolitan cities need to think about. I'm not again talking about any of the four companies here. I'm giving a general statement that if you're focused only on the metropolitan or the big cities, I think there is a market out there which has suddenly been created because of this shift of professionals or shift of people working from home, a shift of people quote unquote going home. That's, I think, a huge opportunity. And the fourth piece which we are seeing is there is a focus on the kind of food that is coming, is the kind of food that is getting ordered. A lot of it is essentials or basic fundamental food. And I would include the pizzas and the biryanis there, apart from, you know, just ordering dal chawal khichdi, right? I think there is a big, big piece sitting right there, which is waiting, because a lot of people who've gone home are not just wanting to order, let's say, a pasta or something high premium, but they are also wanting to order this. So I think there is a customer behavior change. There is a consumer demand change. There is clearly those single bachelor girls or boys living in the city. That crowd is sort of reduced. How do you actually leverage that crowd is something that we are looking at. And the second big piece, be it is honestly for us, is the procurement side. You know, with the logistical nightmares that we all went through, the entire country went through with the lockdown, and hats off to these guys who sort of managed to keep it going, because all their procurement, all their raw materials needed to be fresh, right? So, for biryani by kilo, Vishal must have hit his head against the wall to just get fresh meat or chicken, right? Miftor would have similar issue, and I'm sure vegetables and stuff, Jumbo King and Samosa Singh would have the same issue. I think now the stability into the procurement line, becoming innovative on your supply chains, how do you do your quality testing? Where do you do your quality testing? Because you don't want to now be spending money getting it from the mandi, your warehouse or kitchen, and then testing for quality. Do you need to create mobile quality testing scenario? So I think there is a learning, as Dheeraj mentioned, as to how we are doing this whole supply chain. Ultimately, the biggest fear for us, or for that matter, any food oriented business, be it raw material or cooked, I think is hygienic and fresh. Right. If there is something that goes wrong there, for any business or brand, it sort of drops. It sort of impacts that. Right. So I think, to me, the question then ultimately happens is, what are the processes that have been set in? What are the standards that have been set in? What are the logistic risks, or what are the risks that have been now re-looked at and risk mitigated? So to me, those are some of the things that we've started to look at, and we are looking at it deeply. But ultimately, I would still say all four of these people who are sitting on the panel, I think they've survived because who they are. The quality of entrepreneurship, quality of focus, the quality and just the passion and resilience to fight this out is why they're still here. So my kudos to them, but that's what we look for.
Right. And yes, Vishali wanted to say
something. I think, you know, I just echo what Padmaji said. I think there is no way someone can get out of this and that too, you know, almost like a winner without really being, really hitting their heads on the walls almost every day. This was a difficult, very difficult period. I think keep your team motivated, resilient, and keep doing that communication with the customer. And I think it'll continue for some time. So I think it is a test of the management entrepreneurs also during these times. There will be big winners also when this comes out.
Okay. Fair enough. Dheeraj, I'll come to you. You know, Padmaja just mentioned about, people, more people now working from home are going back to their cities and, you know, operating from there. Does this really worry you, or you think that you need to, expand beyond where you are? Or do you think that it's just a matter of time? People anyway will be moving around the city in Bombay, you know, especially Bombay, I'll talk about. So what do you think of the situation with this work from home? Because people will have more time to, you know, cook something for them at home. You know, they can keep some ingredients ready. So is that something which will take away something from, QSRs or, takeaway counters?
So that's a damn good question, which I get asked a lot. And we have been tracking sales data with Zomato Swiggy, right? Because we sell with them. And not only us, but what other brands are doing, and overall as a platform, what is happening over there. And the data that we have, you know, it is from reliable sources, is that over there also business is down. It's, you know, at about 80-85%. It is not that they have doubled up, right? Ideally, what should have happened is all people, if everybody is starting to order from home, then all the cloud kitchens, the Zomatos and the Swiggies, their business should have doubled up, right? If the shift was happening. Now, we may say that, no, that may not have happened because people are worried about ordering from outside. So, you know, a lot of them kind of did not step in at all. They didn't order from anywhere. So, yes, it is true. There will be a slight shift, as in the cloud kitchen business. Of course, anyway, it's the new age business. It will grow. I know I sometimes say that Domino's is the world's oldest cloud kitchen, right? It is not a new concept. They would put up a store behind the back road and deliver pizzas from there with a number. Today that happens through apps and, through the fulfillment partner. So you don't need to, through a Swiggy, Zomato, Dunzo, these kind of people. So you have to put up your own fleet. So I very strongly feel we should stay put on what our business model is like, so everything, biryani by kilo, samosa, saying wow, momos, jammu king. I think we've all understood at least one part really well, which I think most of the restaurant owners, my father is a restaurant owner from the previous generation, they were making is they were trying to do everything under one roof. So typically at a restaurant over there, all the things that we are serving today plus another 30 things would have been available on the menu in the restaurant. So we have focused on a particular category. And we are trying to fulfill the customer's need for. So it's like, say, biryani by kilo. The idea is if I feel like having a biryani, say, once a week or once a month, depending on what my consumption pattern is, I want to become the number one option in terms of the customer ordering. We remain focused to that. I think the vaccine is going to come out whenever it does, say, about a month away. So my call is stay put. Keep on focusing, super focusing. And yes, we are. So, keep on investing in supply chain. Like our entire supply chain is integrated. All our patties, they come from Fillol, which is next to Chandigarh, right? Because we are buying from Vista. All our sauces come from Cremica. So I think we have spent the last 5 years completely integrating our supply chain, right? And get out, use the better technology so that we are not too dependent on market variations which keep on happening. Like COVID was a market variation which lasted for 9 months. No one could have prepared for something like this, but our wastage, etc., has been at the minimum because the stocks were kind of managed very well. So my my take is yes, we will get into other cities because the opportunity now opens up, right? It is much larger since the supply chain has come in place. It's got nothing to do with COVID. And I think what will happen is a lot of the brands, people are going to trust brands, right? So a lot of the business will move from the unorganized sector to the organized sector. So that is how, I think brands will grow and people trust brands. It's like, you know, if I like Pav Bhaji, I'm a Bombay guy, right? So for Pav Bhaji, I have my favorite Pav Bhaji guy whom I go to, and I have that product over there once a month, right? So that is what the whole thing is about. And I would not say that we should lose faith on what we are doing because of some. See, like when demonetization had happened, right, everybody thought that now finished, everybody is going to start using digital currencies, right? But if you look at RBI data, there's as much currency in circulation today as was in 2015, right? So the cash transactions, they as a currency for buying and exchange of goods continues, but yes, the digital payments has increased. As the market keeps growing, I think all players will keep getting their pie. One pie may grow faster than the other one, but we should remain focused on the pie that we are addressing. And yes, keep on learning. So it's like we have finally launched our loyalty program, right? Because Zomato, Swiggy don't share customer data, which is a big problem. You know, so we can't remarket to them. We don't know who our customer is. We have launched our own loyalty program where there is this product called Thrive, right? Where customers will be able to order directly with us. They'll get it at prices probably 10% lower than on Zomato, Swiggy. And we'll fulfill that order through partners like Dunzo, Shadowfox, these kind of people. So the economy, the environment keeps changing. Instead of thinking Zomato, Swiggy is an enemy, or, you know, that they're going to take this away, we have kind of, you figure out a way to win from that. Mm-hmm. Right. So similarly, COVID is actually a good, you know, I shouldn't say it's a good thing that happened, but it is a lot of learnings for us. And we are not changing anything. We are staying put, but yes, we are going to change gears and get probably go from second gear to fourth gear once the lockdown opens. Okay. I hope I've answered your question, Saurabh.
No, fair enough. I mean, everyone has a different idea. And with that, you know, I'll go to Miftor and Nidhi and I'll ask, you know, so you heard Dheeraj, he says that, you know, stay put of what you were doing. But I believe both of you changed what you were focusing on to, you know, to kind of keep at pace with the change that was happening, that was rapid. So I would want to know from you, is that a temporary change that was done to stay alive? Or because obviously your focus, your USP was not that before, you know, you changed to that. So is that going to be there for with you for a long time? Or is it just for the time being and you will revert to what you were doing earlier?
Yeah, so change is a very good word, and we would like to call it innovation. So till February, life was going as usual. We had about 345 stores that were largely takeaway delivery, and a decent percentage was dining. And it was business as usual. We had raised money last year and we had a massive expansion plan. We had planned to open about 200 stores this financial year as we speak. Then came in a jolt in the month of March, and from April our sales went down to almost 10%. From 340 stores, we were operating less than about 35 stores, and with 10% revenue, with the costs, the level of cost that we had reached across 16 cities, it was a massive, massive infra which had to be moved. So what we thought, we actually thought that there is something that needs to be done, and that thing needs to be done a bit different way. So what we realized is we kind of spoke to these guys, Swiggy and Zomato, and we tried to figure out, okay, what are people ordering? So first thing that they came back to us is people are not ordering food. They are cooking the food at home, but they're ordering groceries. So this was something which was in the month of May, first week of May, last week of April, my dad was telling me, and I was telling my dad that we are going to have your potatoes and sugar and onion to be delivered from our store. And he was like, have you guys lost it? Like, no, this is what the need of the hour is. And this is what people were buying in bulk. So we launched a separate category called Vamamo Essentials. Now, what was essentials? It was that point in time, your big baskets and your Spencers, etc., had a very long waiting time. And the problem which we tried to answer was that, or solve was that, we would give you the essentials, we would give you your groceries within 45 minutes time, the time which it would take for a momo or a biryani or a samosa or a roll to be delivered or a wrap to be delivered. And you would get essentials, your everything that you need for your daily households to be delivered in 45 minutes time. So we went live in the month of May. There was a point in time for about a couple of weeks where our revenues from essentials was more than the revenue that we were doing from our operating, by operating our stores through Momo, and we have another sister brand, Wow China. So Wow Momo and Wow China combined was less than essentials in the month of May. So from that perspective, it was a change that we had to do. But was it a permanent change? Answer was no, because once things started up, once things started opening from the month of June 8th to be specific, we saw the essentials business going down. But the change which was required was still not there. I mean, people had not come back. So what we kind of figured and realized is delivery is increasing. We had to actually increase the delivery bandwidth for the stores. For the rest of India, 345 stores were not enough. So what we did was we did a tie-up with Cafe Coffee Day, wherein Cafe Coffee Day had very large stores and they were not having dine-in, or they were not having any takeaway this thing. No one was going to a cafe to have coffee. So they invited us, we did a collaboration, and we planted a Wow Momo kiosk or we planted Wow Momo stores inside Cafe Coffee Day locations. Now, what would these do? This would actually give us a delivery perimeter of in a place where a Wow Momo store is not there, number one. Number two, we were actually opening up to the delivery radius without actually opening a large store by us or opening a dark kitchen. So we had the infra done by CCD. We had the other facilities done by CCD. We just had to plant a counter there and deliver from there. So this again was a new normal for the month of July and August. But did this actually get the revenue back in total? Answer was no. So we still realized that there is still a gap which we have to innovate, which we have to this thing. We tried to focus. We completely innovated on our delivery packaging. We completely innovated on the way in which the food was being served. We shifted the entire focus, the entire company's focus into health, hygiene, and the way in which the products were delivered. As a result of which, our delivery numbers shot up by almost 100%. Prior to COVID, our delivery was under 20-25%. In the month of June, July, and August, the delivery revenue was between 60-70%. And that was because a specific focus on the packaging, specific focus on operating procedures, specific focus on how you market your this thing. And very important, Vishal was mentioning it, that very, very important was how do you communicate to your customers what are the precautions that you are taking to ensure the food is not contaminated. So that was something that we really worked upon. We worked upon the communication. We did that piece done. We did offers. And what was really interesting was just the offers or the discounts were not driving people to buy your product, because everyone was giving offers, but people were not buying from everyone. People were buying from those brands or those places where they were comfortable to buy from, where they had their trust factor. So all the mom and pop stores which were there, single standalone stores, they did take a very bad hit. But the branded stores, the brands, the chains which were focused on health, hygiene, they were focused on communication, they were focused on the standard operating procedures to ensure the entire supply chain and the delivery mechanism is foolproof, they kind of gained from that. In the month of August, what we realized was, and this was a pet project that was there in our minds for a while, but we started working upon this, is we realized that the entire crowd, once they have opened up, are going to supermarkets and they are taking ready-to-eat and frozen products. They are coming back home and they are heating it up and selling it off. So what we've now done is within 15 to 20 days, we are launching our frozen momos, which will be sold from FMCG outlets like your Spencer's, your Big Bazaars, your retail. And this would be delivered from Amazon and from Grofers and Big Baskets as well. So these are the things that we had to do in the last 4 to 5 months, or rather 6 to 9 months, which actually has taught us to do the business in a different way and focusing. The entire focus was A, to get the top line up, and B, what Padmaja rightly said, is to focus on EBITDA. Because as we talk, a lot of food brands, food companies, they are talking about we have gone back to 70% revenue. we are of the pre-COVID times. We've gone back to 80, we've gone back to 100, we've gone back to 50. But what is really important is how much cash are you guys really burning? So pre-COVID, I would say that it was a great achievement for us that we used to call ourselves that we've been profitable, we've been bootstrapped, and we've been EBITDA positive for the last 12 years now. But March 2020 was the first time that we saw a loss in the investor MIS. The burn was the first line that we added. That monthly cash burn was something that that got pinched in. But our entire focus from the month of April was to save on the cost, to save on this thing, to boost revenues, but to ensure that your burn is limited. And as we talk, we should be able to break even next month and hit steady state profitability from the month of January. But the entire focus has been to ensure the costs are controlled, to ensure the sales get pushed, and to ensure what more can be done to ensure both of these things scale through.
Gaurav, I would like to come here just to make one comment. And, you know, Miftar, when we invested in your company, when we were doing the strategic discussions, one of the lines of discussions or the points of discussions was, why can't we have frozen momos? Okay, which people can buy and take home and cook or fry, right? And it's so interesting. And that time, I think the team, Sagar, had very, very correctly said so, and we agreed with him, that the consumers really want hot momos made fresh. And, you know, this is like walk in and pick up food in some ways, right? But this is the consumer behavior change that has happened, that a company has sort of recognized that change, that there is more eating happening at home rather than on streets. And how do you capture that customer base? How do you capture that consumer base? And that's where the frozen momo piece is coming. I'm sorry, I just could not help, because this was something we discussed 3-4 years ago and say, this is a great scale up model, right? And we were also telling them, you can freeze it like this. Here are the places where you can buy a freezer. We went through quite a few details. So but that's the, I think more jocularly, but I think that's the consumer behavior change, that the customer is not eating on the road, he's eating at home. And that's the customer base that needs to be captured.
Absolutely, ma'am. So we remember the discussions, and we've been actually thinking about frozen momos for almost 4 to 5 years now.
Yeah.
But that customers coming in. So to give you an example, if I go into a Spencer, if I go into a D-Mart, I would not pick up frozen momos. I never used to pick up frozen momos till last year. But now if we definitely pick up something on the ready to eat or something on this thing, just from a snacking perspective. Today, my dad tells me that why don't you get something frozen and have it here? And because it will be more hygienic, it will be more this thing rather than going.
I think more than that, I think people are more comfortable with such food is because of that, virus thing also, because they think that if there is something packaged, I can bring it home, sanitize it, and then open it a little later and eat it. I think that's a behavioral change that has come in. So Nidhi, I'll come to you. The same question that I had for Miftar is that, the change that you there. So you said that you would talk about things that you've changed during this period. So are those changes, are you going to stick with those changes, or those changes were just as you said that, your B2B side, like the PVRs and your supply to work close. So were these changes to just overcome those hurdles?
So actually, like everyone just mentioned their experiences, right? COVID made each one of us realize and learn a lot of things. One of the key learnings, at least we as a company had, were we were in the expansion mode, right? We just raised a Series A and we were very much into expansion, and our expansion was primarily multi-city and in the cloud kitchen domain. What we realized was that until COVID hit us, we always assumed that our production facility is that for manufacturing samosas. We used to manufacture samosas. We used to manufacture thousands and thousands of samosas on a daily basis, 60 to 70,000 samosas per day. Everything was completely automated, quality assured, and everything was going on really fine. Other ancillary things which are a part of our menu, which included some form of chutneys or sauces, or, you know, even we serve the pav and a bhaji, or a samosa and a pav, and that pav and other things we would procure from outside. But what we realized during COVID was that supply chain, one, was a major issue. Number two, we never got the quality that we earlier used to get. There were old pavs redated, or, you know, these are the common things people did in order to avoid wastage. And we realized that that is not only impacting our customer ke saath trust, because like Shah also just mentioned, during COVID, what you really need to bang on was the get the trust of the customers. We were so open. I mean, following the safety standards, hygiene and other things are one part. We were also so open that if any customer did not have a good experience, we would even invite them to come and visit our factory and have a look as to how the samosas are made. So we really wanted to buy on that trust factor. And what we realized until now, we didn't realize was that why is our manufacturing facility just sticking to samosas? You know, why just samosa? We have a manufacturing capability, and that is what separates us from other, you know, similar cloud kitchen players. We don't assemble the product, we actually manufacture it. So why just stick to samosas? And that's when, during COVID, when the lockdown was announced, our factory was operational. We kept doing the hardcore R&D and innovation. And today in our factory, we manufacture every single thing that goes in our menu, be it pav. You know, we manufacture our own pav, we manufacture our own kulchas, we manufacture our own sweets. You know, we just launched gulab jamun because people wanted, in samosa Singh, they needed some kind of sweets as a part of it. Every single thing is made in-house. And that's where, you know, we realized that how to capitalize on your existing infrastructure and not just use it for just the samosas, but even other things that could happen. That not only helped us in bringing down the cost, in cost optimization, it also helped us, you know, with the same lean team that we had in the production, we were able to produce much more SKUs. We were more self-reliant. And that also helped us gain the positive EBITDA, you know, at a higher level at the bottom line. Certainly another thing we realized was that, when you're expanding, you're just focusing on expansion and the top line. When COVID hit, one thing we really had to focus was also on the bottom line. You know, like Padamja just mentioned, there is a shift in the people. They're actually moving out. And that is true. We were in Bangalore and Hyderabad, and we have actually seen that the Bangalore market, people have moved out to their natives. I have a counter at the airport, and the number of walk-ins out of Bangalore is much higher than people coming into the city. And that is why in Bangalore, we are certainly seeing that certain areas, you know, which had the maximum migrant population within the part of the city, which had maximum PGs, maximum colleges, the market there is very, very trim. You know, we don't have too many people there. But as opposed to Bangalore, Hyderabad, which has more percentage of native people, or maybe people have migrated to it, there we have seen a very good rise in the consumption. And that is why, leveraging this, you know, we started expanding more in Hyderabad during this time as equivalent to Bangalore. And today my Hyderabad stores are as many as in Bangalore. So we have made these changes, and these changes are here to stick with us for long. I mean, now we don't even see our manufacturing company as a samosa manufacturing. We see our manufacturing facility as being able to support us to manufacture everything that we sell or do. So these are the things, and because of that, we have really been very, you know, focused on effective bottom line. We have been achieving it at per cloud kitchen level. We have seen that earlier some of our cloud kitchens, you know, would not even reach EBITDA positive, and now they're consistently EBITDA positive since last 9 to 10 months. And just on the cloud kitchen business, we've been just achieving through that cloud kitchen business, we've been able to reach up to 80% of our revenue where we were pre-COVID, assuming the B2B. So now, you know, what COVID has also made us realize is to have the business self-functional, not just dependent on third parties. You know, never someone thought that multiplexes would not be operating for a year. You know, having a business relying on a third party or a business is a little risky model. And that is why, that's the reason we raised the money to actually have our own cloud kitchens and presence across. And that's what we will be focusing on going forward.
Great. I think one of the reasons also you mentioned about the areas where PGs are there, colleges are there, is because colleges are closed right now.
Correct.
So students, that is true. The entire student population is in their hometowns, you know, wherever they are. So I think.
Saurabh, this is something which is happening in multiple areas with multiple companies. I mean, it's not just for us. And that's why when I was speaking to one of the key leadership positions at one of these aggregator platforms, we came up with a proposal. Why don't we increase the delivery radius, you know, from 4 to 6 kilometers to actually 10 kilometers in those target hit areas? And in some areas in Bangalore, where we are primarily operating, this is actually getting functional because there are so less people there and there's so many restaurants, everyone is facing the same heat. Why not increase the delivery radius? So small things we are looking into. And at the same time, you know, some kitchens where we are, where the walk-ins are not as many, where the orders are not as many because of the number of people are less, we are operating on a lean team versus the other location. So just trying to manage the demand. But overall, we've seen that thankfully, even during COVID, and even now post-COVID, the delivery demand tailwinds is really high. We have never seen any dip here, be it Diwali or other, or overall, it's been really going well. But certainly there has been a slight 10 to 15% variation because of the migrants moving out of the city.
Vishal, I'll come to you. So, you know, we heard Dheeraj, we also heard Nidhi that, you know, there have been changes in menus. Nidhi said that they have started Gulab Jamun. Now, tell me something, like your USP is biryani. Now, if you start another food, you know, an item, add another item or two to your... But, you know, my favorite Gulab Jamun place is XYZ somewhere, or my favorite, anything, it could be anything that you add as an add-on to your menu. Does it really help in, you know, adding to your demand for that food? Because I know you for biryani. Now you start giving me Gulab Jamun with at a small incremental price maybe. Okay, I might order it a day or two, but I really the taste for my Gulab Jamun could be something else. So do you really think doing that will increase your demand, or do you think it's just that you are ensuring that people are getting everything they want along with biryani to eat, asal and a sweet, everything together, so that, you know, you give a complete, putting up a complete meal for that consumer?
So Saurabh, I think you asked a very, very important question. I think this is the most important question I think F&B companies should answer. Mm-hmm. And, you know, with due respect to everyone on the panel, we have some differing views. And I think closer to what Dheeraj said, closer to his views, that, you know, changes have to be strategic in nature and very long term, right? This is an age of specialization. See, there is a reason why you don't see Domino's frozen pizza on the shelf. There's a reason why KFC's frozen chicken is not sold on a Modern Bazaar or a Spencer. There's a reason for that. See, it's not that the management worldwide in Domino's has not thought about it, or because the management DNAs and the whole systems are geared differently. If let's say a prosumer, which is a momos company in the frozen category, they've done a great job with FMCG and the modern trade. There are like millions of general trade in this company, in this country, and the salespeople who are just doing that, and how the customer views a frozen pizza or a momo or a biryani other than a... And even in grocery, let's say something like a Grofers or a Big Basket is burning millions of dollars to get the back end and the tech. It cannot be done in a few months or even in a year. You know, it's impossible. So until unless a change is very strategic in nature, and like Dheeraj said, even after demonetization, you know, after 5 years, the cash has come back. So today, biryani by kilo, we do as a strategy 10% of our business through dine-in and 90% delivery. So I'm not going to shut off my 10% dine-in because it's a COVID, right? I am taking a 10, 20 year view on biryani by kilo being a $1 billion company. And those one dine-in in each city for the 10% dine-in is important for my brand connect. Just because it's COVID, I'm not going to shut them off. It's a part of my 10-year strategy, right? Until something is a part of your 10-year strategy, it has no meaning. Until unless you are doing it for a very tactical reason for your bottom line, just to survive, right? So a lot of even the cloud kitchen companies, to answer your question directly, you know, they will say, okay, we want to, you know, instead, other than biryani, let's do pizza. But see, there's a very great company which is doing pizza, you know, like Domino's, but how can you be better? Can I have 1,300 outlets or have a supply chain of Domino's or you know, the reason we got into biryani also is biryani is a great delivery category. We thought about it 5 years back. And also there is no incumbent leader neither in India or worldwide. So today we are almost a 100 crore company and break even, right? Not making any losses in 20 cities because we focused on it. You know, we focused on creating, there's a reason why KFC doesn't do pizza or Pizza Hut doesn't do chicken or Starbucks doesn't do, it's not as easy as it sounds. The supply chains, the trainings, the mind share, the advertising, the, you know, everything, it's a mammoth job. You know, with the best of efforts, a company's, you know, Chipotle does Mexican. You know, that's what they're able to do. So until we believe something is a 10-year, what you can do is a view, you can't really change. But tactical things can be done just to make profits or survive. But you can't just change gears because competence and abilities for a company take years to build. In that, even in, I would say people think it's a cloud kitchen. And see, cloud kitchen is just an enabler. See, customer finally build is the food, it's a taste, it's a quality, it's the price, it is the brand, right? Cloud kitchen is just enabling me to do it at a lower capex and do have a higher speed of execution. But a customer doesn't love my brand or the product, cloud kitchen is useless, right? So it doesn't, so people think just because they have a cloud kitchen, they can put four brands and four categories in it. But how do you create capabilities, supply chains, trainings, wow in that product, in that pizza or in that samosa or everything? How will you do it? You can't do it on an opportunistic way. It has to be done over years with capabilities, the DNA, everything.
Yeah, Nidhi, you wanted to say something.
No, I was just saying that what Vishal is saying is absolutely true. But here there's one more angle to it, which is the cloud kitchen domain is a little tricky and a different because it's 100% driven by the customer's impulse. When it's about, the breakfast, when it's about the lunch or the dinner, the meals, right? People actually do decide it, you know, they're more focused. They know that they have to have biryani and they have certain, their favorite players and they would go by that. There are certain segments where we're dealing with, which is India's snacking, you know, the snack segment that is highly driven by impulse. What people would want to have during snacks time, between 3 to 7 p.m. window, they want something which is, light on the pocket. They also want something which is like a tangy and a chatpata kind of a snack. They don't want it a heavy meal. And it's 100% driven by the impulse. Now, what happened during COVID was we realized that there are certain things which actually picked up the demand. There was a certain surge. For example, just around April time, our best seller has always been the samosa. In fact, that is 80% of our revenue comes from samosa and the other things are just ancillary because it needed to be there so that it caters to the multiple demands from a particular family. Now, during COVID, what we realized, people started ordering too much of, chai along with the samosa. The reason being there were so many bachelors. They may not have the provision to make tea in-house. And that's when we realized we just had one variety of chai, which was a masala chai in our menu, and we never really saw such a huge surge in masala chai along with samosa because samosa chai is like a combo and it started selling really quick. Then the next thing we saw was during COVID, people started avoiding curd based things, the curd, because they had this the feeling that it might they might fall ill or whatever, and they started asking for something hot, hot chaats, samosa chaat, but without the curd, or just similar things. Or maybe Sagar, Shah can add that it could be like hot momos or something which is really hot in nature. And that's how we started seeing the trend. One major trend which we saw during the COVID was the average order value for any cart actually increased significantly. I think it could be because there are multiple people in the family, and I'm sure everyone in the panel would have observed the same. And there are certain demands that started coming in, because when you're ordering through any aggregator, you actually do not have the provision yet, to order a snacks from Samosa Singh, to order some appetizing momos from Wow Momo, to order a proper dinner from Biryani by Kilo, and maybe have a nice sweet or a dessert and then kind of close the entire cart and go about it. So you actually have to order from a one particular restaurant, and people would want that apart from that speciality, you have a few things here and there. So here, what I'm trying to emphasize here is that very well resonating with what Vishal said, that your focus always has to be on the core product. People would come to Samosa Singh for samosas. and not gulab jamuns. They would come to Wow Momo for momos, and that's there in each of our names as well. But at the same time, there are certain things we have to have in our menu items. Definitely. Certainly they would. And there are certain items that you have to have in your menu that actually complements your core offering.
So Nidhi, we also have at Biryani Bank, you know, we are very proud of our kebabs, kurmas, finni.
Correct.
So that completes the menu, but that's a 10-year view we have taken from day one.
Correct.
So whatever, and you know, COVID can create, you know, certain different views, but those views have to be for another 10 years, not for another 6 months.
Absolutely. Yes.
It cannot
absolutely
be done because you are finding it opportunistic to do for the next 6 months or 1 year.
Right? Very true. And I have seen
channels,
certain
the channels. So I think someone who can be good in TV doesn't mean they can be good in movies. Someone who's good in movies cannot be good. So just because they know acting or direction, you know, it doesn't mean much. So what you are creating for a frozen product is very different. The mindset, the packaging, the companies, although, you know, Wow Momo is a great company and I love Saga, and see, they might be able to, because this might be a different thing, but generally it's easier said than done. The whole management bandwidth, how it is focused is very important in the resources you have. Every team has certain resources of money, time.
Alice, trying to, this thing is, it's very important, is you need to understand what your core business is. So someone who's selling bread and butter, the core business is bread and butter. He can bring in a chai to sell along with the bread and butter.
Right.
But 75% is going to be bread and butter. So even with us, if we try to do our essentials, or if we try to do into FMCG, it's a new business line that we are trying to this thing. Are we shutting down the old stores? Answer is no. Are we dividing? Are we removing the focus from the traditional QSR that we've been selling from the last 12 years? Answer is no. So when someone throws a challenge to you, so like COVID, it's a challenge. You should look at it as an opportunity to see.
No, first, Raman, as long as I'm saying, so as long as you're giving a 10-year view, it's okay.
To deliver, and B, if yes, then why not take it up, provided things allow.
I agree completely. As long as it's a 10-year view, it's perfectly fine.
I'll just want to let Dheeraj wants to say something. Please, Dheeraj, go ahead.
I think Nidhi's company, na, they are younger. They're
we can't hear you, Dheeraj.
Yeah. I think he's frozen.
Yeah, he's frozen. So anyway, you know,
I'd like to make a point while Dheeraj comes.
Please go ahead.
So if ever you look at raising money or anything like that, please give me a call. I am investing now. Okay, I hope you never need to raise money, Vishal. But if something happens, please.
You're saying to me.
Yes. Okay. Thank you. What I want to say is that, you know. Okay, it's like we are learning from the international QSRs. When Subway puts up 78,000 stores worldwide, right? That is what gives me goosebumps. Okay? They have their manufacturing entirely outsourced. They don't do a single thing themselves. Okay? They have their entire front end with franchisees. They don't have a single store of their own. And you look at...
I think we're losing Dheeraj.
Your voice is breaking up.
Can't hear.
Anyway, Padmaja, you wanted to say something till the time Dheeraj.
First of all, I really enjoyed this because I learned the maximum. For me, this was like ready-made gyan coming into me. So thank you.
Only aapke paas itna gyan hai, aapko kaun de sakta hai?
Dheeraj, I think. Dheeraj, I think we can hear you now, so you can want to finish.
So I think we as Indian, so, you know, there was talk about quality control when you outsourced it. Today, when we were making our patty ourselves, okay, we were making it at 15 rupees a kilo, the conversion cost in our kitchen. When we moved to Vista, our manufacturing cost increased by more than 2.5 times. Now, please understand, that is a 100 crore infrastructure. The call was, let us tie in with the best in class manufacturers and get the economies of scale in by giving them large volumes. And that is the way we can get to 5,000 or 10,000 stores in the country. If we keep on trying to control our kitchens, thinking, so, you know, you'll not get the right quality if you go to the wrong suppliers. The right suppliers are going to be more expensive. So I think the call that, so we as companies, we need to understand that because we are in the business of brand creation. That is where the real IP lies, right? Yes. And whatever can be outsourced should be outsourced, but find great partners who understand quality is important. Why does McDonald's outsource everything? They don't make everything on their own, right? They have the money, the wherewithal to do everything themselves. But, you know, the brand partnerships can be such. Today for us, we trust Vista to do a damn good job with the patty making. Then, I would have trusted my own manager at a factory. And one last point, you know, was about this frozen momo. So we had got this offer where someone said, you know, that the Jumbo King patty is extremely tasty and that's what people come for. And we should package it and put them out at all the QSR, at all the modern retail stores. And I got damn excited. I was like, wow, ye toh karna chahiye. It's a separate business, a separate line, and we can do very well. But when we ran with the math, what we realized is that it will unfocus us so much from our core business that we are better off building Jumbo King into a $1 billion business. This is where our focus should lie. And the QSR space, the model that we are operating, can get us over there. So I think one of the most important things for an entrepreneur, see, because we have investors on board, of course, you know, but
yeah, just frozen a bit.
Hello? Yes, go ahead.
Right? So what happens is getting the buy-in from your investors to understand that because the investors always come in with the best intention when they invest. And in times of COVID, you know, solutions start coming up from all directions because you're not being able to give them a solution basis your past thinking. But convincing them and staying put is a very important skill that an entrepreneur needs to have where you take the investor along. So, you know, I have had a lot of pressure. People said, yeah, we should do this. You know, what is happening? This I'm talking of, you know, that we are now in our 20th year. And I remember those pressures used to be really tough. But I say, no, remain focused. So, you know, everything that Vishal said, that is focused by Alrice and Jack Trout. And that was what I would keep saying in every meeting, that Starbucks does one thing, Subway does one thing. You know, in the pizza category, Pizza Hut does the dine-in, Domino's does the takeaway. Pizza Hut tried doing the takeaway, they do a damn bad job. Domino's tried to do the, the seating in. I said, I feel like I'm in a hospital when I go to a Domino's store to eat over there. I will not go there with my family, but I will call for it at home. So once we understand it's the user need which we need to get a pulse of and become the best at that, I promise you all the brands over here have the potential to become $1 billion businesses and go outside also. So that was my...
Sure. Thank you. That was really fair enough. And, you know, we've run out of time, but I'll come to Padmaja before we wrap it up. So two things. I think first you wanted to say something. And the second, my question, the sign of question would be, so, you know, do you think that, you know, I'm going to see a walk-in store where, Miftor has put his momos and Nidhi has put her samosa and Vishal has put his, biryani and Dheeraj has put vada pav together. So, you know, rather than I specialize in biryani and I try to get, make momos, rather I would start getting those things together. Do you think there is going to be collaborations as such, which might happen? I'm not sure if that can happen, but just asking.
I kind of just go first at this.
Okay.
I think what we'll do is we should all put up one store next to each other and make it into a food court. We don't need to put it up in the same.
Yeah.
That's a great idea.
Right? We all take up.
Let me answer this differently. I think, first of all, I completely agree that food itself is a brand play rather than, yes, the brand has to be defended with a good, high quality product. Hygienic, fresh, et cetera, right? But it is a brand play. If the brand is not there, it's not going to work, whether it's a niche brand or a scaled up brand. You know, you go to a very niche, high quality boutique restaurant, it is the brand why you're walking there. It is the brand which is demanding the premium prices. It is the brand that is sort of getting the customer into the door. That's, so I completely agree, it's a brand. Number two, I think what I'm gathering, and I personally believe there has to be a model of scale if you want to grow. Without a model of scale, it doesn't work. What you do in-house, what you do, what you outsource, how you manage that outsource, your SOPs, your processes, your logistics, et cetera, I think that is very important. The third piece that I think is very important, and I'll share this, that may be a difference of opinion, but I do see this, is there are times when you take a strategic decision. Okay, and let me expand that a bit. There are reasons why you internally take a strategic decision without any external trigger. For instance, when Mac decided to come in India, it decided to make some changes on its menu, for example, right? And yes, that strategic decision has to continue for a decade or more, like Vishal said. But that's a conscious strategic decision, is one way of looking at it. The other way of looking at a strategic decision, that the company may need to take, is due to an external factor. For instance, and I'm going to stay away from the four brands that are sitting on this panel, I know of a brand which is into coffee. Okay, coffee, fresh coffee is something which is a takeaway. It's made there and you pick it up and it's pick up and go. And certain brands are driven by socializing, by the fundamentals of socializing, and certain brand or food items are driven by the fundamentals of social, they work towards social distancing. If I just look at Biryani by Kilo delivering, they started by delivering food at home or and parties or catered, right? So I think for them, the social distancing that happened because of COVID and lockdown and pandemic and blah, 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 they were aligned to that. But there are coffee brands out there, which is you get out of the airport, you pick up that coffee, that completely got killed. So the focus still has to be on survival. And then you have to start thinking, which they did, and I won't give the name of the brand with due respect to the brand, is that they decided to say, if my core product or my core products differentiating factor is my coffee powder, is there a way that I can continue my business, continue it during COVID and beyond COVID by packaging that coffee powder into sachets and selling it online? So that is a strategic decision that they were pushed into taking because of COVID, but they must, and we had a long discussion with them, they had a clear-cut reason to do it on an ongoing basis, and it became a permanent line of revenue in the P&L. Yes, of course, did they have to make changes in bringing the right equipment, the right people, the right packaging? Yes. But those are resources that you need when you build the revenue line of a company. And this is a line of business. It needs to sit as a P&L under the main P&L. There must be people who, and everything needs to work like any other business. So that's the second big piece that I think strategic decisions have to be taken. The last thing, I think, to your point, Saurabh, I honestly feel that, and perhaps I'm a wrong age group, I will put my reps and warranties there, but honestly, when we order food or we buy food, irrespective of whether you dine in or you order in, I think we at least go by the brands. We would want to go to Biryani by Kilo purely because of the biryani, okay? The add-ons are more to say, is this a complement to that food, like a salan or a firni or whatever, right? Do I want to have the convenience of being saying that I have a family of 10 and somebody wants a biryani, somebody wants a Jumbo King, which, by the way, I do want a Jumbo King, which I haven't eaten for many, many years. And that's Dheeraj on your head. Do my children want a Wow Momo and does someone want a samosa? Yes, I do want the convenience of being able to order from either a platform or go to our outlet and order it. But I must also, as an investor, as a consumer, be ready that when you are collaborating in a food mall, online or offline, you have to agree that you should be able to go to the specialist to buy it. I personally think that there is a huge value, and I'm now wearing my investor hat. There's a huge value in a specialized brand. If Wow Momo is doing momos, then I am going to be focused on Wow Momo doing momos. And if I am wanting Wow China, then I will go to Wow China and I will have the Chinese there, if that be the case. But I will not probably go to Wow Momo and have Chinese. And that is the demand of this business, which is branding and the brand, the product behind the brand. That's how I look at it. And ultimately, I think whatever model we do, it has to be scalable from the entrepreneur perspective, from the investor perspective, and the customer perspective. You cannot have, if you really want to scale, unless you want to say, listen, I'm going to be one single outlet, dine-in, premium food, I'm eliminating those businesses. There are many such businesses, right? And they're good businesses. But in our discussion point, if I want to have a biryani of Biryani by Kilu, it doesn't work for me if they are only going to serve in Gurgaon and not get it in Noida. I mean, I'm never going to be a customer for it. So I think accessibility is the other piece that needs to come through. And how that is accessed is also very important. So I completely agree with Vishal to say cloud kitchens are enablers. Absolutely. It's a resource. It's a tool. It's an enabler. It's like having a kitchen in-house or out-house. You know, it's one more way of cooking or preparing.
So finally, it's the product or the brand which works.
But what is the product needs to be defined, Vishal, here. And why I'm saying is I'm taking it beyond the four of you. Is that if the coffee is the product, then the coffee powder is the product, or is my process of making coffee the product? That's the distinction.
That's if a company or an entrepreneur has to decide.
I can't decide that. But if it is the coffee powder, then there has to be different ways of mining, monetizing that product. If it is the process, then there is a very different way of.
Like you rightly said on this example, Nescafe sells coffee powder. And Starbucks sells coffee. So those are two different brands, not one. Starbucks cannot sell coffee powder. Nescafe cannot sell coffee.
Absolutely.
So those are different things, people. Just because it sounds coffee, it is all very different.
Yeah. And I think situations like COVID, okay, push people. And all of us are humans. Remember that, okay? I think situations like what we went through of lockdown and pandemic and social distancing, pushed each one of us, not only you guys, let me say, each one of us to get down to the fundamentals and basics. We had to rethink, what is my product? Who is critical to me? How am I doing this today? Can I do it differently? Right? Why in our business, the first question that came up, we have a two-floor office, do we need it? You know, till then it was taken for granted. Arey, office ke bina kaise kaam chalega? Conference room ke bina kaise kaam chalega? Yaar, kaam kya chal raha hai? Usse jyada paise humne invest kar diya bina conference room ke. You know, I think those fundamentals get questioned, and I think it's a damn good thing to happen, honestly, because we keep running with, you know, day in and day out. We don't get a chance. We don't spend the time to question.
In fact, one of the best thing that COVID did was it gave us a lot of thinking time. So going back to the blackboard was something which we were actually not getting time to do. And we had days and days at length, at peace, to actually kind of course, after firefighting on the daily activity and ensuring the payrolls and the rentals and the vendors get paid. Apart from that, the free time that we actually got, we actually were able to rethink as to where are we heading.
Yeah. Actually, I got presentations and food presentations. Okay. I got business plans where guys were asking me for 25 crores. I promise you this has happened. Okay. And we were discussing, why do you need 25 crores? COVID hit. 1 month later, they said the same proposal, same thing, 15 crores. Runway, instead of 20 months, it went up to 36 months. It just, and it's damn good, because for the entrepreneur, why should he dilute? Why should he give away more than he needs to? So I think it's a good thing to rethink. And I honestly feel the most expensive way of raising money or funding your companies is equity money. Please don't raise money from investors if you can raise it, if you can fund your companies through revenues or any other means. Revenues is the best way to do it.
So we have really run out of time, but I think Dheeraj, you want to make a point. So quickly, if you can make that.
Thanks. Thank you for this, Saurabh. So, you know, just answering one of the points that Padmaja mentioned in her last conversation was, see, I think for to simplify or oversimplify this, it is all about category playing, right? So Vamomo has created a new category called Momos, and their sole objective should be, because I am going to be in the top three players in this category, because challenger brands will come in, right? So Indian food market, because it is so largely unorganized, so Samosa Singh, I think they have done a brilliant job by finding a category which is very large and unbranded and created a brand out of that. Their focus, you know, like what Vishal kept saying, the next 10-year focus should be that was this entire samosa category, the pie which is there. I want to have a 51% market share nationally. And how large is that opportunity? And stay very, very focused on that. So, you know, similarly, biryani by the kilo. So once we understand that which category am I operating it in, and so okay, either I create a new category or I go into an existing category. So like Jumbo King, we now have repositioned ourselves as the Indian burger. We are seeing, because nationally we feel that burgers is a larger market. There are these, you know, a lot of these players who have made very, very significant investments and created the category. We would be love to be in the top three in the burger category rather than spend a lot of money in creating vada pav as a category. So, you know, once these decisions are made, then within the category, how are you positioning yourself? Premium or mass? And that is, once you get this part right, you'll see all the other elements will fall in place. Whether I manufacture, I outsource, I put up company owned stores, I franchise, you know, all of those things will fall in place. But the key decision is what is my category and I stick to it. So like in Wow Momos, if I'm giving the restaurant experience, I have to give the best restaurant experience when it comes to momos. While when it comes to the, you know, the modern retail, frozen momos is going to be a very different category. My free advice kind of, Mr. Hood, to you would be, try it out, do a dipstick, but probably don't call it Vaha Momo, call it something else. You know, you would have straddled the whole thing and taking all of it. And but the customer should not come to know, because see, I think CCD, you know, made this error where they were this very nice 1,000 square feet store. And then they put up those chota kiosks at railway stations, if you remember, CCD Express. And I'm like, what the hell, yeah, I am expecting CCD to be this very nice experience. Ye to yahan par mere ko, you know, cup mein dal ke a very unclean looking vendor is giving it to me for 20 bucks. So CCD, the brand, took a hit over there. They should have actually called it something else if they felt it is a large enough opportunity.
So Dheeraj, we'll pick your brain up on this. We've done a strategy and we are not calling it specifically Vamomo Frozen. There is a separate packaging which goes into it, but we will discuss with you. It will be a good lengthy offline discussion.
Okay, I think.
Make sure the advice continues to be free.
So I'll have to stop it here because we've really overshot the time by quite some time. But I know that this discussion can go on for another quite 2 hours maybe, because of the interest that we all have in this category, which is food. I mean, it's one thing that everyone. Works, bolte hai ki jeene ke liye khana, khane ke liye jeena. Obviously, jeene ke liye khana, but khana jab jee rahe to acha kyun nahi khaye. So we all need good food.
Khane ke liye jee rahe hai, kya baat
hai? So thank you everyone, and for this very healthy discussion. And I would really wish to see all of you again together, maybe 3 months, 4 months down the line, and reflect back that what we have talk today, and let's see what where we have reached at that point in time. Yeah. So thank you so much, and wish you a good day. Thank you.
Sarah, one request. Thank you. If you just give our numbers to each other.
Yeah. So we have all.
We are talking to Padmaja ji, and I need to speak with.
Have all connected on the mail. The mail addresses are there in the connecting brief. So in case you want, otherwise we can do that as well. So
we pick it up from there.
Yeah. Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Great meeting with you guys.
Thank you.
Yeah, bye. Bye.